can fly out in the sun. You know what I mean, don't you know? Butterflies are having fun. You know what I mean. Sleep in peace when day is done. That's what I mean. And this old world is a new world and a bold world.
All right, folks, we're going to get started. I love that song. I love it, but we have a lot of work to get done. And we're going to keep seeing people join us, but I'm going to get us to the business at hand. If you are a first-time person on this call, I would love for folks to raise their hands. Is this the first Superwomen Wednesday for anybody on this call? Let me see here. Got all the tabs open, so it's hard for me to see a little bit. There we go. We got some hands raised. Amazing. Well, welcome. I'm going to quickly tell you what this call is, what the space is, and then we're going to move forward. All right. So if you're new with us, Superwomen Wednesday is our bi-weekly call where we get a chance to come together as a community and hear about a really important topic that's either impacting us nationally or at a local level. And then we get to work together to build that progressive women's voting bloc, and then we take action on a tactic. And as many, if not all of you know, this week we are going to be talking about student loan debt and the effort to forgive student loan debt in light of the recent Supreme Court decision. We have a jam-packed agenda tonight, but first I'm going to go over some quick group norms and a little bit of some other information here. So as far as our group norms, since we're here virtually, we just want to make sure that everybody has a safe space and a good experience. So we want to make sure that folks are encouraging of each other in the chat. If you feel yourself, this has never happened during my tenure, but if you feel yourself wanting to argue about anything or sort of get off topic, just refocus on what's happening in the call. We're going to stay on topic. We're going to be on camera if possible. And if life doesn't allow that, that's absolutely fine. But I find it's a more pleasant experience when I can meet the lovely faces of the folks that are joining from around the country. And we are going to have folks stay on mute unless prompted to talk. We are hopefully going to have some time at the end of this call to ask some questions of our special guests. And depending on how many questions we have, we might have folks drop it in the chat or maybe come off mute. But just drop any information that you have in the chat if you have any questions, and we'll try to get them to them as quickly as possible. All right, so I have a couple other things to go over, and then we're going to get to the work at hand. But before we do, Paloma helped me out there. Add a plus in the chat if you're on the same page with me on all of those rules. Just so I know folks are listening, because sometimes it's hard to join the audio on Zoom. I find myself struggling sometimes. Awesome. All right, I see enough hands raised and things so that we know we're on the same page. Okay, so when we talk about gender, that vision is expansive. Gender is a human-made construct, and we believe that anybody who is impacted by patriarchy is part of our work here at Supermajority. So this is not a full list here, but if you are a trans woman, a cisgender woman, non-binary person, a trans man, anything in between in the gender spectrum, and you're fighting for the cause of ending patriarchy and all the systems that harm all of us, then we are with you, and we hope that you'll continue to be with us. And so we just always talk about that because for some folks, it's new information. For many of us, it's not, but that's our perspective on that. We're going to be real respectful and kind to everybody around us so that they can live in their full selves. Let's quickly talk about Supermajority. So we have something that's called the majority rules. For many of you on this call, this is not new information. We're going to go over it really quickly, but it's basically our political platform and the orientation of our organizing as an organization. We have 5 majority rules. I'm going to show them up on your screen. And these rules were created in consultation with over 75,000 women and femmes from all across the country, from every state and territory. It's an intergenerational and multiracial group of folks that helped to come up with this long before I started at Supermajority. But as you can see, the first rule is that our lives are safe. The second rule is that our bodies are respected. The third is that our work is valued. The fourth is that our families are supported. And the fifth is that our government represents us. And as I said, we're talking about student loan debt today. Wednesday. And that really hits on a lot of these rules that are up on the screen here. We need our work to be respected. And if we can't even pay rent or do all the basic things that we need to do in our lives, that's not really folks being respected. Our families need to be able to thrive no matter what the economic situation, and student loans are a burden on so many of us. And frankly, too many politicians have promised us progress on this issue and they have broken their promises. And so we really need a government that represents us and is going to stand by us no matter what. All right, we also have a super rule that we're going to show you really quickly. It's one of the most important things about the way that we do our work. It just basically means that when we are figuring out how to provide solutions for all the world's problems and work together to make the world a better place, we want to make sure that the people who are most directly impacted by those problems are at the center of not only the policy solutions we decide to fight for, but of our organizing work itself. And we know that across countless movements, Black women have been at the forefront of so many different things that have benefited all of us. And so if we're not doing that, if we're not following that super rule, we're not organizing the right way. So we always remember the super rule. It's up there on your screen. And I hope that you'll take that message with you in whatever work that you do out in the world. Let's quickly talk about the agenda for tonight. It's pretty straight to the point. I'm going to say a few words about my thoughts on the student loan debt crisis and some of the ways that it impacts folks. And then we're really not going to listen to me for that long because we actually have a pretty great expert on the call tonight, and I will introduce her in a moment. She's going to share some really great information about how you can get involved in the fight to end this horrible burden on all of us and really get the government to take collective action. And then we are going to talk about some calls to action that she has helped develop at the Debt Collective. And then we're going to give you some next steps with Supermajority, and you're going to be hopefully out and on your way with the rest of your evening on time at 8 p.m. Eastern or whatever time it is in your time zone. All right, so let me just vent for a moment with y'all, but let me just quickly check the chat and make sure nobody has any questions before we move forward here. It looks like everybody's okay. All right, cool. So I want to name the fact that there might be some folks on this call who don't actually have student loan debt of their own, but I'm willing to bet that many people on this call have student loan debt, and that is a great factor in why they made time to join us tonight. And I want to challenge all of us on this call, no matter whether you have a few thousand dollars in student loan debt that you are going to easily pay off, or if this is something that's a constant stressor for you, that we are all going to care about this issue. Maddie, who I'm going to introduce in a little bit, is going to talk all about all the ways that this is actually a deeply harmful thing for women and femmes especially. And collectively, as we're fighting for all those majority rules that we just talked about, we really need to care about this issue. This is a deeply problematic crisis that we need to address immediately. So I want us to think about what has been going on the past couple of years as we meet this moment we're just about to have, where we're about to be told that we have to start paying those student loans again. How many people on here, really had an easier time during the pandemic as a result of not having to pay those student loan payments? I'm going to raise my hand while I wait for other folks to answer. Yeah. So Maddie, definitely. Yep. And let me just view who else. Yeah. So this has been actually like a rare good thing in public policy that they decided, like, we're in the middle of a humanitarian global crisis. We're not going to make this another thing that people are going to worry about. It has probably been the difference between people staying in their homes, people being able to pay for food, people being able to go to the doctor, being able to take care of their kids in lots of different ways, while some of them have had to deal with virtual school and things like that. And a lot of those factors are still playing out. COVID numbers are going up. We've got folks who throughout this pandemic have been evicted. I'm going to read a quick stat that I looked up a couple of days ago. This is not even a national number. This is just a snapshot. So this is actually like not the best statistic, but over at Eviction Lab, which is this research hub that was developed by a number of economic researchers, including author Matthew Desmond, they took a look at 10 states and 34 major cities. So not the whole country, just a snapshot, like I said. During the pandemic, 2.45 million evictions took place. I think a lot of people think that all that was paused, right? I will share with you that during that pause, I was someone who very nearly lost my housing. And like, purely because of government breaking down, right? We've got folks that are still hungry, that they're losing out on those child tax credits. They're losing out on all these other different things, and the economy is not working for them. And meanwhile, folks are demanding of them to start paying their student loan debt. And they were promised by President Biden and many other elected officials that this was going to be addressed. Now, I know what some of you are thinking. The Supreme Court made this decision, not President Biden. But as Maddie is going to talk about, there are lots of things that our elected officials can do in light of that decision. This fight is not over. It's a matter of political will. So anyway, I am going to stop rambling because we really want to hear from our expert on this. We are not going to settle for the situation. Can I hear here in the chat or raise a hand if you agree that we're not going to settle on the situation? And you're going to be even angrier about this once you learn more about this whole situation. We're not settling. Yep. All right. So let me quickly introduce you to Maddie. Maddie Clifford is the deputy press secretary of the Debt Collective. I don't know if y'all follow the Debt Collective, but I hope by the end of this call, you're doing lots of work with them. They're absolutely amazing. Maddie is a writer, musician, and deputy press secretary with the Debt Collective, the nation's first debtors union. She holds an MFA in poetry and spent almost a decade teaching creative writing classes to incarcerated youth. Her work covers topics ranging from climate justice to abolition feminism, and she's had the privilege of serving as a hip hop diplomat in both Uganda and Argentina through the Next Level USA program. And I'm sure there are many more things we can say about Maddie, but Maddie is gonna come on screen now. We're gonna give her a second because Zoom is a little slow. And Maddie has all sorts of things that she's going to teach us about how to think about this problem and how we're going to fix it. So Maddie, I'm going to hand things over to you. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Colleen. And thank you for having me. I'm so honored and blessed to be here with you all today. I think one of the things that's really important about this issue about student loan debt is that it is a women's issue. It's an issue that affects the majority of Americans. One in five Americans actually has student loan debt. And I think sometimes in my community, I'm representing Oakland, California, or AKA Ohlone territory. And people ask me, like, why are you doing this? Like, why are you so involved with student loan debt cancellation and abolition? And I say, because I've always been about feminist issues, and this is a feminist issue. This is an intersectionally feminist issue. And so I'm super excited to talk a little bit more about it today. And I'm also really grateful for Zach. Zach is going to be helping me with my slides, and they're going to be the person that's going to change the slides for me. So I really appreciate you, Zach, for doing that. So again, I think one thing that, like, the general population hasn't fully sunk into is the idea that student debt is a woman's issue. And so today I want to talk to you about that, but I also want to talk to you about how we fight to win, because we're not just fighting for no reason, we're fighting to win. Do you mind doing the next slide, please? So this is a photograph from an April action that the Debt Collective was involved with. And the Debt Collective is the nation's first debtors union. So similar to the way that a workers union organizes around labor, we organize around our debts. And what we do is we use our debts as leverage to push for full cancellation. We use the term cancellation, not forgiveness, because we haven't done anything wrong. And we also fight for reforms as well as for public goods to be fully funded, right? So we're not just about canceling the student loan debt. We also fight for free college for all. And so we'll talk a little bit about more about that later, but I want to start with talking about the severity of the issue. We know this is a problem. Many of you on this call probably know firsthand what this issue feels like viscerally. So also I encourage you to take, you know, a moment, take self-care, self-compassion as you're listening, because these aren't just statistics, right? These are things that are really impacting real people. So Americans now hold $1.7 trillion in student loan debt, and two-thirds of that debt, so at least $929 billion, is held by women, right? So anytime you hear people talking about student loan debt, know that it is disproportionately impacting women, right? Next slide. So one of the main reasons why this is happening, there's various reasons. You know, as women, we know that it's all about intersectionality, right? All the intersectional identities that we hold. But a big problem that contributes and worsens the student loan debt burden on women in particular is the gender wage gap, right? So what it does is ensures that it takes longer for women to pay off student debt compared to their white male counterparts, right? So across the board, the gender wage gap, but we have to understand, right, it's compounded for women of color because they're facing both the gender wage gap and the racial wage gap together, compounded. And actually for Black women in particular, we talked earlier, you all talked earlier about how Black women are the most burdened by student loan debt. They miss out on over $1 million over the course of their careers. And so this missing out on money, this way that we are not paid the amount that we deserve to be paid, at the same time that we often get advanced degrees to be at an equal playing field or to feel like we can be comparable for the same job prospects, we often take out more debt than it takes longer for us to pay it off. The result, women end up paying more for the same degree. That if that's confusing, please feel free to ask questions in the chat. But inevitably, we talk a lot about how student debt is a poverty tax, right? Because people that have less money end up having to take out more student loan debt in order to get degrees, right? It's harder for them to often complete their education. Even let's say you're first generation, for example, you might be more likely to drop out. A lot of people that have student loan debt, it's upwards of 40% of people with student loan debt never finish their degree. So they don't benefit from the degree, but they have the debt. So those are a couple of statistics that just show how difficult the situation is for a lot of people. Next slide. So how did we get here? This question cannot be answered in a short amount of time. It would probably require its own complete presentation. But one of the main things that a lot of people don't know is that college was actually free in the 1950s. Well, it was low cost. State schools were low cost and even free in places such as California. And this was a time when these college campuses were predominantly upper-class white men were able to attend college, right? And as integration occurred, right, the civil rights movement, we start to see the college campuses diversifying, see women being able to go to college. You see people of color being able to go to college. And this also, the diversity of college campuses even opened up new fields of study, right? These worthless degrees, people say, right? We know in our hearts, these are not worthless. There's no degree that's worthless, right? But what this ended up doing was inevitably there was the conservative backlash against that, something that we're seeing to this day. There's a lot of parallels with affirmative action, right? And Ronald Reagan actually built his political career first in California and then nationally around really trying to crush the leftist, the diverse populations on college campuses, starting with Berkeley, but other colleges. And he realized one of the prominent ways to do that was to make college expensive or to start charging people for college. And Roger Freeman even said that there is a dangerous educated proletariat. Let's make them pay for their education. There's a lot more that goes into how we got to the student debt crisis we're in today, but that is one of the key issues that I think a lot of people don't think about and don't put into context, especially the fact that college used to be affordable, right? College used to be free. It was just a certain population that was able to go to attend college. Next slide. So what are the impacts of student debt? So this is a big issue that a lot of people, again, don't necessarily think about. I think one of the key reasons people don't talk about the impacts of student debt enough is because student debt also makes people feel ashamed and it makes people feel isolated. I'll speak from personal experience. I owe over $120,000 in student loan debt. And it was something that caused so much shame that sometimes I would burst into tears when I talked to family members about it. And I felt personally responsible that I had made horrible financial decisions. Mind you, I was 18 years old when I signed up for these loans, 20 years old when I signed up for these loans. And it wasn't until I found the debt collective that I realized, wait a second, I'm not alone. And it was also talking to people in my community. I started to realize, wait, I've taught incarcerated youth for almost a decade. I feel like that's a pretty good, I've done the work, right? I also found that one of my friends, she works at a DB shelter. She owes $70,000 in student loan debt. My other friend taught at an elementary school in our community. She owes $50,000 in student loan debt. And I started to think, hey, something's going on here. Is this personal responsibility or is it really bad policy? And so let's talk about what this policy, what this student debt crisis is doing to people. Thank you, Zach. So here are some of the social and racial implications. Again, there are a lot more, but the biggest thing to take away is that student debt and debt in overall worsens already existing racial and social disparities, right? So any social disparity that already occurs in our society is only worsened through student debt, right? So for example, I spoke about how Black women carry the heaviest student debt burden of any other demographic. So because of the fact that Black women support 80% of Black households, this means that student debt has a catastrophic impact on Black wealth overall. In fact, if they were to cancel up to $50,000 of federal student loan debt, it would increase the Black wealth by about 40%. It would have a huge impact on Black wealth overall. Another thing to keep in mind is that people often think of student debt as this kind of millennial or Gen Z issue, but it burdens people from every walk of life that you can imagine. In rural areas, for example, red states stand to benefit more from student debt cancellation than blue states. This is really affecting poor folks like in middle America and in red states. Also, older women are affected by astronomically high student loan balances. Sometimes their social security checks are garnished if they can't pay. Also, disabled women, lesbian, bisexual, trans men and women are all disproportionately burdened. Right? So it worsens any issue that you can think of. It's just made worse through student loan debt. Next slide. So these are a collection of, so one of the things that the Debt Collective does is we write a lot of op-ed pieces. We spend a lot of time writing about how this impacts, not just the statistics, right? We talk about people's real lived experiences. So on the left-hand side, I'm not sure if it's on your left, but I actually wrote a piece about my own personal story. I mentioned to you all that I owe over $120,000 in student loan debt. And I actually wrote a piece called A Degree or a Debt Sentence. You can read it in Prism Reports. And I talk about my own journey and kind of talking about my personal experiences and how they are indicative of a larger systemic policy failures, right? Another powerful piece that we were able to publish in The New Yorker, The Aging Student Debtors of America, tells the story of elders with debt and really showcases the ways in which this is an issue that affects every generation, right? And then lastly, I saw this really cool piece that just came out recently, which talked about Summer Lee, who owes over $200,000 in student loan debt. And she talks about her personal, you know, experience. And I thought that this was interesting because we're seeing more and more people in government that actually have student loan debt. And that is making an impact on the conversation. And I think that's a good thing. So what are some of the health impacts? I think some people don't also talk enough about the health impacts. So debt essentially is about, we talked about it's a poverty tax, but it also is punishing. Inherently, it's punishing. So the stress and shame that comes with it actually has a physical toll on people's bodies and mental health as well. So a survey conducted by Student Loan Planner found that 1 in 14 borrowers have experienced suicidal ideation. And I bring that up to say that it's really important that we take care of our mental health. And also, I feel like one of the most important things about telling our stories is so that people can see they're not alone. They're not alone. Talk about it. Talk about how you feel so that we can all talk about why we matter and why we have to work together in order to solve these problems. Also, something that was brought up at the beginning of the call is even if you aren't personally impacted by student loan debt, know that it is impacting people throughout your community, right? It impacts each and every one of us. And then another issue is, according to CNBC, when student loan payments resume, 50% 56% of borrowers say that they'll have to choose between their debt and buying groceries. So this will actually affect people's physical health. Next slide. Right, here are some more essays. So one of the most important things that we published recently was we published a lot of writings around the Supreme Court case against Biden's student debt relief plan, which was bogus from the very beginning. Again, there is a lot that goes into explaining just what went down with Biden's student debt relief plan, but just to keep it short, it would have canceled up to $20,000 of student loan debt. It would have helped provided $400 billion in economic relief to working class Americans. And it was struck down off of, the major questions doctrine, which is a really bogus loophole that conservatives are using to take away a lot of our rights, not just student loan debt, but also when it comes to abortion, reproductive rights, as well as affirmative action. And then we've written other pieces. I want to definitely shout out Freedom Dreams. So that is actually a documentary that talks about Black women and the student debt crisis in particular. So what is on the horizon? So I talked a lot about things that are, you know, very stressful, very negative feeling, right? But I have a lot of good news for you. Okay. I have a lot of good news. There's more of us than there is of them, right? There's more of us. We're angry. We are loud. One of the things I love about the Debt Collective is when I first found out about them, I realized you can strike your student debt. And I didn't even know how that worked, but I wanted to know. And that was something that motivated me to get involved. And now I work as the deputy press secretary. I also do a lot of social media. And one of the things I love is that we've been able to reframe the conversation. And we are a small group of individuals, but we've been able to get in front of a lot of the misinformation that's been spread about student loan debt. And we've been able to organize people around fighting back against student debt. So we believe at the Debt Collective, we've been pushing and pressuring President Joe Biden to cancel all federal student loan debt. Yes, all of it. That might sound radical, but radical is simply grasping at the root, okay? If they can cancel PPP loans, then they can cancel student loan debt. If they can, in a matter of 48 hours, make sure that people that Silicon Valley Bank was bailed out, they can cancel all federal student loan debt. And we have a lot of reasons why we push for that, but the main reason is we want to grasp at the root of the crisis and we want to cancel all federal student loan debt so that we can then fight for college for all. So next slide. Thank you, Zach. So again, big thing is organizing and you can get involved in so many ways. And I'm gonna tell you a little bit about that now, if you don't mind. So once again, we are a debtors union and we're the first debtors union in the nation. So we use our debts as leverage. So what we really are pushing for is for mass cancellation. And one of the things that people don't understand is that Biden has the legal authority to cancel all federal student loan debt. We like to say that the Biden administration has a Swiss Army knife of legal options that they can utilize in order to cancel the debt. And we know that they can do it because the same legal authority that allows them to put a pause on the student loan payments allows them to cancel student loan debt. It's actually held by the government. The government owns the debt, so they can simply decide not to collect on the debt. We have advocated that he use the Higher Education Act of 1965. Biden chose to use the Heroes Act of 2003 to implement his plan, still completely legal. But what happened was the Biden administration, with the rollout, they took 6 weeks to administer the application for relief. And this gave conservatives ample time to throw bogus lawsuits at the courts. There was about six of them and two of them stuck, right? We know that the Supreme Court right now is more conservative than it's been in a century. And so conservatives and the right in general are utilizing that to take away our rights. And so that's one of the main reasons why the Biden student debt relief plan was struck down, but he still has legal options that he can utilize. And we need to keep continuing to pressure Biden to do the right thing. And especially because his plan did not follow through. And now people are being, because, you know, they negotiated the payment pause to be lifted. as part of the debt ceiling deal, now people are going to be forced to pay. And the saddest part is that Trump was the one that actually administered the pause on student loan payments. So do you know how bad that looks? We're like, Biden, we want you to look good. We want you to get votes. And this is how you get votes, by canceling, mass canceling student loan debt. Let's go to the next slide. So this is just like some laughter I wanted to add in. A lot of people are already talking about not paying back their student loan debt. And we have strategies for actually not paying. So it says COVID cases are surging violently. Hawaii is on fire. And many are dying. The earth is hotter than hell. Groceries cost as much as a Bugatti. Gas as much as a Rolls Royce. And Biden wants me to pay my student loans back. No, it's not going to happen. I feel that Biden was definitely stopped from implementing his plan. But again, it's important to understand that they have a Swiss Army knife of legal options that they can use to cancel student loan debt. So his plan, you can think of his plan as just one option out of many, one that was fumbled a bit, and that he still has many legal options. Next slide. Thank you. So one of the things that we want to reiterate to people is that alone our debts are a burden, but together they make us powerful, right? And so one of the things that I feel like is really powerful about the debt collective as well is that for a long time, people didn't talk about the student debt crisis. It wasn't even brought up. It was kind of like everybody just accepted the fact that people, a lot of working class people in particular, had to go into debt in order to pursue an education. And now, because of pressure, because of making sure that our voices are heard, now all politicians at this point are talking about it on both sides of the aisle. They have different arguments, right? But at the end of the day, what I've found is that Americans overall know that this is a crisis. They might have different ideas about how to solve it, but there's powers in numbers, and there's more of us than there are of them. Let's go to the next slide. Okay, so what we do when we organize is we encourage debtors to dispel the shame they feel about being in debt. That's key, right? As I was talking about owing $120,000 of student loan debt, it doesn't bring me shame. Like, obviously, being in debt, you can never escape this feeling. It's like a nagging, gnawing feeling that follows you no matter what. But I don't feel the same way that I felt in the past. Now I know that I'm not alone. It's like I have connective tissue with a whole bunch of other people, particularly women, right, that are also dealing with this issue. And our debts are actually rich people's assets, right? And the debt collective has actually bought people's debt for pennies on the dollar. And we've done mass cancellations before. And we've been able to cancel billions of dollars, not just in student loan debt, but also medical debt, carceral debt, and school lunch debt. We also talk about how you are not alone. So it's really important for us to cultivate solidarity amongst people so that they understand that you aren't personally a failure, but you're a survivor of systemic policy failure. That's a really important point that we bring up. And then we've also, as I mentioned before, really reframed the national consensus. So it's really important to continue to tell our stories, because we get a lot of people that make arguments that simply aren't true. But, you know, honestly, I've been doing this for a couple of years now. And in the beginning, it was really stressful, like arguing with people online. Oh, you took out the loan, you should pay it back. But then I realized they kind of repeat the same five arguments. And so if you all need any help on how to debate with people or how to explain a lot of issues, then feel free to message me, because I've had the same conversation over and over again. One of the biggest things is student loan debt costs taxpayers money. And what's interesting about that is that student loan borrowers are taxpayers, right? That's one key issue here. And B, it actually doesn't have to cost taxpayers money to cancel student loan debt. As I mentioned before, the federal government doesn't budget like a household, because it issues its own money. And so there are actually legal ways in which people student loan debt can be canceled without costing taxpayers. Again, we've been pressuring the Biden administration to use all legal tools available to cancel federal student loan debt. And then also one of the things that we've done that we're really proud of is we've supported the Carithian 15. So they had private student loan debt. So as we're talking about student loan debt, a lot of the time we're talking about federal student loan debt just by default. But remember, there are millions of people that even though the pause was in effect, they still had to make these payments and their interest rates are through the roof, right? And the Carithian colleges defrauded millions of people. And so we were able to help them win cancellation. So that was really powerful. Next slide. So what is next for us? For I'm going to provide you with a couple of things that you can do next to get in collaboration and connection with us. So I also put in this joke, I'm not paying my student loans if there are aliens, sorry. And then I said, tell the Department of Education you've been abducted. Braxton Brewington is the press secretary. And so I love joking with him. Okay, next slide. So first and foremost, you can join the union. So unionized workers and unionized debtors are more likely to get their debt canceled. Unionized workers are more likely to make more money, right? We see this movement happening with unionization for workers. We are part of that, but we're talking about debt. We help people cancel their debt through repayment plans, but a lot of the time we are also just organizing debtors. Not just around student loan debt, but rent debt, carceral debt, medical debt, school lunch debt, in order for us to be, for social goods to be available to all. Because what's happening is people are having to go into debt to debt finance their basic needs, shelter, education, right, housing. And then I just read this, that a whopping 62% of borrowers say that they are likely to boycott loan payments when they resume this fall. Half believe that mass refusal to pay could help push for full debt forgiveness, while many simply say they can't afford it. Next slide. You can also donate to us. We are a small organization. This is also a tweet that I saw today that we were able to help someone apply to and be awarded PSLF. The programs that that the federal government offers for student debt cancellation are notoriously bureaucratic, incredibly difficult to navigate, and like 90% of people have been denied historically. And so we help people. We have a legal strategist on our team. We have a lot of folks on our team that help people get cancellation that they should be getting, especially for working for public service for decades almost. Next slide. So I just want to thank you all again. I want to leave space for questions because there can be a lot of questions. It can be an issue that people have questions about, and I want to make sure I answer those. But I also want to shout out, we also have a book. So it's called Can't Pay, Won't Pay, The Case for Economic Disobedience and Debt Abolition. The foreword is by Astra Taylor, and Astra Taylor is one of our founders of the Debt Collective. The Debt Collective began with the Occupy Wall Street movement. So it has roots in the Occupy Wall Street. And we are very lucky to have be a woman led organization. And these are some of the links that you can use to get into contact with us. Linktree provides all of our events. We've got so many cool things going on. The Debt Collective website has a lot of information as well. You can message me directly and you can follow us on Twitter or X or whatever it's called now. So that's about it. So thank you so much again. And I'm excited to hear your questions.
So Maddie, while people have a chance to like write down some of their questions in the chat so that we can start to like bring people off of mute, I'm going to ask a few questions that I think will help people to think of their questions. But before I do, I just want to like underscore some of the things that Maddie just said, right? So, and Maddie, correct me if I'm wrong on the statistic. I didn't go back and look at the document, but it's like 2/3 of our student loan debt is owned by women. Is that correct? 2/3. Yep. So not half, not 52%, 2/3 is owned by women, and we all make less money. So that like, it's such an inequitable system. And so frankly, any elected official that's not doing everything that they can to solve this crisis, they are patriarchal in their actions. They have to do something about this. They expect our votes. They expect our labor moving into 2024. They need to do something about this. The second thing I just wanted to quickly lift up is just that that the debt collective works to help eradicate lots of different types of debt. And I think that's really important in a conversation around gender, because raise your hand if you feel comfortable, folks, if you have any medical debt. And it's okay if you don't feel comfortable, but I'm going to raise my hand and just say, I have medical debt. And drop in the chat or raise your hand if you have credit card debt or a mortgage or potentially other types of debt, right? Lots of people, right? And so this is just one facet of that. Okay, so I just want to make sure folks picked up on those couple of themes, but I have a quick question for you that is always top of mind. I've been like sort of lingering around your Slack channel for a while because I've been trying to figure out this issue for myself and figure out ways I can help. But obviously different folks have different levels of pain threshold when it comes to this, right? We're advocating for folks to potentially not pay their payments. And I'm going to tell folks right now on this call, and y'all can keep me honest, I don't think I'm going to be making any more payments for a while. Like President Biden has an on-ramp of 12 months, right? So, but there are some folks that they simply cannot afford it. They cannot afford for the risks that come with that. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about what some of those risks might be and like how people can sort of decide how they want to get involved and how they want to resist the system.
Absolutely. So again, if you check out the link tree, you'll get all the information on what we mean when we mean strike, but I'm going to explain it a little as quickly as I possibly can. So when we talk about striking, we talk about anyone that is as close to zero monthly payments as they possibly can get. It doesn't automatically mean defaulting. We are well aware of the legal ramifications, all of the stressors that come with defaulting. For example, people's wages can be garnished, your credit score is destroyed. But we also want to keep in mind that some people will be forced into default because some people simply can't pay. For example, if you're thinking about if you can pay your rent or if you can pay your student loan debt, what choice are you going to make? If you're thinking about whether you can pay for your food, and again, we're talking about women, so we're talking about families. If you can pay for your own food and your family's food, which one are you going to choose? Right. And, or again, healthcare, all of these debt types actually are interspersed and intermingled, and they all affect people's inability to pay. And so we have solidarity with people that go into default. Actually, before the pause in student loan payments, one person was going into default every 26 seconds. Okay. And so, but when it comes to striking, we also understand people may be comfortable with different things. So we actually have on our strike page, which it's, if you go back, there's actually the link to the strike page, I believe. If not, I can actually put it in the chat, but we have several options that you can take. So there's different, you know, like you can use income-driven repayments. One of the challenges is that it's always changing. So we like to, when we find out exactly what's happening, then we share with the masses what they can do. And that's one of the main reasons why I tell people to join the union, because you'll get the information right away. Another way people could strike student loan debt is by being in school. So if you're a student, you're striking student loan debt, right? So there are a lot of different legal means that people can take or ways that people can go about striking without going into default. But some people will be forced into default, and that's just the facts.
Yeah. So
that's kind of like the short answer to that question.
I saw a bunch of comments in the chat. And correct me, Maddie, if any of my information here is incorrect, but so Melissa in the chat said, what if you don't have income? My understanding is that with income-driven repayment, you can have $0 payments. So like, I just want to lift up that information to folks. The other thing I wanted to lift up, this is just my personal experience, but just so that people have awareness of, is that depending on who is your servicer of your debt, they might not have had to participate in all the regulations with the CARES Act. And so I had part of my loans unfrozen the entire pandemic. They refused to freeze them and they went into default. So I had to consolidate those. I only share that experience just to say, like, even when the worst happens, there are ways to get out of it. I'm consolidating those loans out of default. But you can do everything you're supposed to do. And those companies are not going to do everything they're supposed to do. So like, I just sort of want us to challenge the idea that if we are perfect stewards of this broken system, that you'll eventually just pay everything down. Obviously, if that was the case, many, many women and many people would be paying us down. Let me just quickly, check out in the chat really quick. Sorry about that.
No, course.
It's moving so fast. The other thing I just wanted to lift up, because you talked about it, I think a little bit, or maybe you talked about it with me before this call. I can't remember now, but you do a lot of really great work at your organization with storytelling. You were talking tonight about the issue of shame. And I was wondering if you could talk to folks about not only how people can share their stories of holding debt, but how folks who might not be experiencing this right now might be able to also help and be an ally.
That's such a great question. I think that I never really understood how much my shame impacted the way that I navigated the world until I started organizing with the Debt Collective. For example, I'm an artist. And so I, in the arts community, I would, you know, some of my friends and peers who don't have student loan debt, they would just kind of be like, why is she always asking about payment? Why is she always hustling? Why is she so business? Like, people kind of saw me as being like a little bit too obsessed with money. And then I realized, like, sometimes people that don't have debt don't really understand what it's like to have negative $120,000. Right? And how much strain and stress that causes. And so it impacts our relationships with one another. And so I think people, like, now my friends, I have friends that are in all different types of economic levels. Now my friends are starting to see, like, how many people are impacted, how unfair it is. And they're really, like, you know, helping me get opportunities, making sure that I'm sharing my story, being there for me. So I think that we can be more aware of how we can be there for one another. And chances are, even if you don't have student loan debt yourself, you can even tell your story about what it means to have privilege. For example, one of the things that people don't talk about, you know, there's a lot of, like, obsession with taxpayers are going to have to pay for student debt cancellation. Again, not true necessarily. We don't talk about the way that tax breaks, the fact that wealthy people can get tax breaks when they have certain, you know, they save money for their children to go to school tax-free. You know, they're avoiding paying taxes. So in a way, they're paying less taxes so that the wealthy kids can go to school without having to take out student loan debt. So you can also talk about your own privileges. You can be more upfront about that. I think that does a lot to help in the cause of people that are suffering from student loan debt. Also, you probably have, you know, family members that are affected by student loan debt, by some type of debt. At the end of the day, all of us are being impacted. And so I think it's really important for us to tell our stories more often and to talk about it a lot more often. And if you don't have student loan debt, I would definitely try listening a lot more. I've had experiences where people weren't really privy to what was going on and said things because they just didn't really know. For example, sometimes people will say, well, I didn't go to college. So, like, I don't know why you went to college. You shouldn't have gone to college. You're in solidarity with me. You decided not to go to college, to pursue an education, to pursue your passion because of student loan debt. That's not a good thing. We are comrades in this, right? And I think people don't always think about that. And so there's a lot of ways for us to connect with each other.
I just want to, like, lift up the fact that I don't think anyone on this call probably feels this way, but even if you're someone who never went to college or someone who never had to take out student loan debt, like, the fact that people are holding all this debt, that affects you. Not, oh, I feel sorry for that person. That means that someone is going to delay medical care. That means that someone's not going to be able to pay their other bills. And that has an economic ripple effect on all of us, right? The other thing I wanted to lift up is just that there's all sorts of economic factors that are affecting women. In addition to all the things that you just talked about on this call, like, in many states, people have to travel further and further to get abortion care. And that's, like, an economic cost. So I wanted to lift up a quote from, like, one of my favorite people that I follow online. She's a disabled activist from Pennsylvania, Imani Barberin. I don't know if anyone follows her, but mm-hmm. She said that we've been trying to tell y'all that carceral systems don't necessarily have to have walls. And, like, when I think about this system, like, certainly it's not the same as the suffering of being in a prison cell, but it is a means of control. Right? We're seeing, like, a lot of folks in the chat who have very individualized situations. And I'm wondering if it would be okay for them to, like, email the Debt Collective. Is that okay?
Absolutely. Yes. I think you should email us at the Debt Collective. Okay. Because, yeah, it's hard to answer it all individual questions because they're everybody's experiences can be so different.
Yeah. But
we're really here for you.
So I forget if you went over this already. I want to quickly go over a couple of your calls to action. I guess they're up on the screen, technically, some of them. But I want to make sure that folks get involved here. And then we're going to see if there are any questions after that. But I want to make sure I don't forget to do this. So Paloma's going to help. Oh, Paloma lifted up a great question for me that I forgot to ask. So the donations to your organization, do they have to be monthly in order to join the union? That was a question that someone asked.
No, actually, in order to join, so there's donations that could just be donations in general, but, or you can like let folks know about us, but there's also union dues. So if you join the union, then we will ask you to pay union dues, but you don't have to pay union dues. You can actually opt out. You can say zero, I'm pretty sure, or you could just opt out of paying any dues. The reason that we put that there is because we actually, our goal is to be completely funded by union dues. We haven't gotten there yet. Right now we're a nonprofit.
Oh, and then Colette just brought up a great question that I saw before and then I totally forgot about. Thank you, Colette. There were some folks wondering about how it works to sort of resist the system if you don't necessarily have student loans that are held with the government.
Yeah, so one of the things about having private student loan debt is actually there's a lot of ways that you can organize with other people. And so again, I would definitely recommend joining our union. For example, one of our biggest successes was with the Carithian student debtors, and that's a private organization, or that's a private for-profit predatory. They're some of the most predatory colleges, right? That was defrauded. And so the student debtors were defrauded and they were able to have all of their debt canceled. So oftentimes going against using our debts as leverage, actually going against private companies can actually be easier than going against the federal government, because the federal government doesn't even need our student debt payments. Can you believe it? They don't actually need it. And so it's hard to withhold our payments from them. Has different effect than withholding payments can have for even private companies. So all that to say, there's actually a lot of power in organizing around debt cancellation against a private entity.
And correct me if I'm wrong on this, but my understanding is that all these companies have to keep records of your debt, and a lot of them don't, right? And so that's like a real vulnerability for them, that you could say, okay, give me all the records of my debt. And if they don't have it, you could potentially start to fight back for cancellation. Is that true?
Exactly. Yeah. There's a lot of strategies that you can use. I think when it comes to federal student loan debt in particular, our biggest thing is power in numbers. And also this idea of not just can't I pay this, I won't pay this. Mm-hmm. I won't pay this because it shouldn't exist. This debt shouldn't exist. And it's inherently predatory. And this policy that has caused this crisis is wrong and needs to be remedied.
Two more questions and then I will let you go and we'll talk about our next steps with Supermajority. I'm going to keep this first question general, because I saw a couple of people with this information, but say someone has like a medical issue or a disability, I'm pretty sure that there's opportunities for forgiveness or for at least pausing your payments. Could you speak to that?
Yes. So we actually, again, if you click for the link tree, we actually are organizing disabled debtors right now. So please get in contact with us, because there are strategies and avenues for cancellation if you have a disability, depending on what that disability is.
And then I have two more quick questions. The first one is it possible to stop paying your debt without it affecting your credit score? Is there a way to do this? And I'm guessing that the way to do this is to do a mixture, right? Like you stop paying, or you pay a lower amount.
So that's really, yeah. And so just like you said, Colleen, you're so expert on this issue, which I love, is you mentioned how there's going to be a year before we're going to still be there's going to be interest accruing, but we won't have to make payments for a year. So that's something to remember. And then when it comes to stop paying, we have, again, if you go to our strike page, there's different options that you can use. For example, our biggest goal is for you to get to as close to zero monthly payments as possible. So you can do that through income-driven repayments, income contingent repayment plans, to try to get as close to zero as you possibly can. And of course, we don't want it to affect your credit credit store. Usually it would affect your credit score if you defaulted.
And I just want to, as a general disclaimer for any folks on the call who have student loan debt that's not necessarily held by the government, check into the information about whether or not this is a good idea. And I want to offer as a resource that the Debt Collective has like a huge Slack channel where folks help each other figure out these things. So don't just say, oh, I don't want to do that. Don't be afraid. It'll be okay. But you should definitely connect with the Debt Collective so that you can figure out what all of your options of resistance are. And then the last thing I wanted to go over is someone asked really quickly about their debt being bounced around and like how to figure out about that. I've definitely been experiencing that lately. I'm wondering if that's like a very common occurrence in your experience with the folks you've
been working with. It's very common. The more you learn about this issue, the madder you'll get, especially because the Department of Education continues to renew contracts with these horrible companies like Mohila, which actually was part of the lawsuit against Biden's student debt relief plan. And so, yes, you're going to see a lot of, like, and that's one of the main reasons why we have a legal strategist on our team. And we work with, we work in solidarity and collectively to understand this bureaucracy, to try to find out what legal means and avenues we have for debt cancellation. So that, again, I would definitely recommend joining our union, joining our Slack channel. And I think one of the most powerful things about this entire issue is when it comes to economics, when it comes to the issues that women face economically, this is something that we, instead of feeling shame and secrecy about, we can speak more openly about, and we can help each other. We can help each other get these debts canceled, and we can help each other fight for free college for all so that future generations don't have to deal with the stress and strain and anxiety.
All right. So just to wrap up, I'm going to ask Paloma to drop those links in the chat one more time from Debt Collective so that folks can use them. But just want to remind everybody that college used to be free when it was mostly men going to college. Are we all fired up and ready to go about this issue? Are we committed to staying involved in this issue? I want to see folks chiming in the chat. Raise your hand if you're fed up. All right. Everybody thank Maddie for all this amazing information. And can folks raise their hand if they are going to take some actions with Debt Collective? I just want to see. And we are going to try and email out some of this information tomorrow to you all. Fantastic. All right. I already see some great activists here. So thank you so much to Maddie Clifford, the Deputy Press Secretary of the Debt Collective. We are going to quickly go over our next steps with Supermajority. So first up, we have on August 23rd, we have the Majority Leader Speaker Series. It's the final of our series. We're going to be talking about the majority rule, our government represents us. And you can read more information by following the link that we're going to drop in the chat. We also are going to have a Superwomen Wednesday just like this one on August 30th, and we're still building that one out, but we're going to be talking about the issue of gun violence as it relates to young people and especially kids going back to school. So you don't want to miss that. Finally, the last two asks I have of you is if you know you're not going to be around for a while, you're on vacation or things are getting busy and you can afford to make a donation or a recurring donation, even $5, any amount can do. That will really, really, really help our organization to continue to build power among women and femmes all across the country. And if you're thinking of someone who should have been here tonight, who would have loved this call, I want to plug that we are going to be posting this recording in the next couple of days. And you should bring them to the next event. We're going to drop a link in the chat for folks to join as a member. Let me just give folks a second to see those links. And I was talking real fast, but Paloma's on top of it. The best chat person in the business. So, all right, folks, we are going to play some music out. Thank you so much to Maddie Clifford. And we are going to email some of this information to you tomorrow, but I hope to catch you at our next call. And thank you so much for being an awesome organizer here at Supermajority.
Like blah, blah, blah. Louis, that. sexy on my brand new foreign car. Don't act like you forgot. I called a shot, shot, shot. Like blah, blah, blah. Pay me what you want me. Don't act like you forgot.